Joining us is Professor Ben Burgis. He is the author of Give Them an Argument, Logic for the Left. He teaches philosophy at Rutgers. You can hear him tonight and every Tuesday night on the Michael Brooks Show. He also has a Patreon account. I guess they're called accounts. Everybody go to patreon.com/Ben Burgis, BenBurgis. You can sign up for 2 essays a week, plus some extra videos. Support this man. He is very generous. He comes on this show and answers all my stupid questions. And I've been going through the essays. They're fascinating. And I would say, I don't want to be... Well, let me just say that trying to filter life through Marxism, not that I know anything about it, has made my life much easier. And being exposed to you and Michael Brooks is almost as good as talking to a therapist, because when I go to work, sometimes I get emotionally invested in the job. And I'm looking for things that the job can't provide to me. And then I think about Professor Ben Burgis and Marxism, and I'm reminded, no, this is just about making money. Don't take it personally. This is somebody, let's say, stealing your time in exchange for money. Somebody sucking a little of your life force out of you in return for money. That's the healthiest way to work in our system, isn't it? To be reminded that transaction.
I think it could be tremendously liberated to remember that that your boss is not on your side. You have opposed interests, and a lot of the stuff that people worry about and doubt themselves about, is really truly not their fault. Some of it's your fault, but a lot of it is just about the way the system is set up.
The system is set up to, and I hate to use these terms, to exploit you. And if you don't understand that you're supposed to be exploited, you're going to be miserable. So much of my unhappiness, doctor, has come from thinking the guy or woman who's handing me that paycheck actually cares about me, because they do use forms of control to convince me that it's more than just money.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, I think it's interesting that a lot of the times the places that are the worst to work for work hardest to convey that impression, Walmart doesn't have employees, it has associates.
Mm-hmm.
We're all members of the same team or family. A lot of the worst jobs, managers will be called team leaders or things like that. Because of course, in those jobs in particular, if people have the idea that that they do have opposed interests, they might start, organizing for those interests, and they might put up with less.
Here's what I want to do today, because I thought we would talk about one of your essays, but let me get my arms around this conversation, because I think I have an idea where I want to go with this. But first, as I always say, yes, Let's plug your Patreon account. Give the URL so people can support you. And I have a feeling that after today, the people listening to my show are going to be much happier after hearing you talk. A lot of people are starting their work week. They're coming off a 3-day Memorial Day weekend vacation, going back to work. I think we're going to make you happy. But first, how do people go to your Patreon account? Give them the exact information, please.
Well, I hope I can live up to that. That kind of makes it sound like I'm going to clear out their Thetan levels. But it's www.patreons, that's patreon.com/Ben Burgis, B-U-R-G-I-S. And as you said, yeah, you get two essays a week, and also an extra video. The ones that have been written so far, the two for last week, were about why to engage with bad faith right-wing arguments, and what, if anything, people should conclude from the most recent election in Australia. And the one that's up for this week is about Karl Marx and egalitarianism, and kind of more broadly, in what sense the left cares or should care about equality, what kind of equality do we care about, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. So the Michael Brooks show is the best, and Sam Cedar is the best, and it's for operating thetans 5 and 6. The David Feldman show, we're new to the cult, and a lot of my listeners follow politics very closely. Maybe we don't get into political philosophy the way we should, and that's why I'm glad we have you on the show. My son spent 2 years in Germany reading Marx in the original language.
Nice.
I guess it was German, right? Although yes. he wrote in English too, didn't he? Wasn't he a journalist as well?
Yeah, he did some journalism in English, but most of his books were originally written in German.
My son said to me, "You were never a happy man." He said, "You would have been a much better employee, a much better comedy writer, had you filtered your experience through Marxist interpretation of capitalism, that some of the most successful capitalists are Marxists. As I've dipped my toe into work and cashed some checks grudgingly, miserably, watching my soul being crushed, I realize he's absolutely right, that I was brought up to believe the lie. My father got shipped off to the Pacific. He got mobilized to fight World War II, came home, was a loyal foot soldier for capitalism, put on a suit, got on the train, and worked for somebody, worked for a general, and obeyed his orders, was told, if you follow these rules, you will be rewarded. And he had this dream for me that I would be my own man, I'd be an entrepreneur and thrive in this system. And I never did. It just felt rotten to the core. It's a lie, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, certainly there are a lot of reasons that, you know, people can make themselves miserable that have nothing to do with the economic system. But like, if you are told this lie that you're talking about, that people, you know, that if you, as Bill Clinton always liked to say, work hard and play by the rules, then, you know, everything will turn out fine. Then very often when it doesn't, you know, you're taught to blame yourself for that, you should have worked harder. You should have done things differently. But once you realize that, that this isn't a system that's really designed to sort of maximize your human potential. This is a system that's designed to, you know, to squeeze every penny that can be squeezed out of you, which is all that exploitation means, by the way. You know, you mentioned that earlier. And so exploitation is just the idea that, any kind of business venture, you know, whether it's a factory that produces widgets, or, you know, a writer's room that produces comedy scripts, you know, that is like any kind of business venture, the product is produced by labor, right? Mm-hmm. You know, they have that they be the people, by the people who are employees. They're actually making the widgets or making the script, as the case may be. But because the way that ownership works the way that it does in a capitalist society, there's the separation between ownership and labor, that the people who own the business venture are rarely the people who are doing the work. So that means that because they have the structural ownership position, you know, they can like slice off for themselves this huge chunk of the wealth that you create, if every ordinary, assembly line worker at General Motors disappeared tomorrow, then it would grind to a halt, or, you know, maybe they'd be able to replace them. But, you know, like if everybody who, who was capable of being, you know, an assembly line worker at General Motors disappeared tomorrow, they would produce not a single more car, they would make not a single more penny. If the shareholders disappeared tomorrow, that wouldn't be a problem. Or, you know, if it's a problem, it's only because the system is set up, you know, to make it a problem, because you could certainly organize things otherwise so that, you know, the workers themselves would run the place. And so, you know, you don't actually, you know, you don't need shareholders, you know, you don't, you know, maybe you need some kind of management functions, but, you know, you certainly don't need the kind of, you know, the sort of bloated corporate, you know, executive vice president in charge of X, Y, and Z structure that you have. You know, you could just have, you know, you could just have people elect managers. So yeah, I think that there is, I mean, I don't want to overstate the point. You know, I've always liked, you know, Sigmund Freud said that the point of psychotherapy was to reduce hysterical misery to ordinary unhappiness. And, you know, I think that you could say something similar about socialism, that, you know, that trying to get rid of, you know, poverty and severe economic inequality and the kind of alienation and exploitation that are built into this kind of form of social organization we've got right now is, yeah, I mean, it's going to eliminate a lot of sources of human misery, but, you know, not all of them. You know, mm-hmm. there's still, you know, there's still romantic heartbreak. There's still, you know, existential, you know, lack of meaning. You know, there's still all kinds of things, but, you know, but it's an improvement. You know, it's reducing hysterical misery to ordinary unhappiness, right? You know, I'd much rather have a society where people have the leisure time to, you know, to feel unhappy because they know that they're never going to like write a great novel than, you know, to have a society where people are miserable all the time because they're trying to figure out how to make rent.
What is the difference between egalitarianism and socialism?
Yeah, so egalitarianism, roughly speaking, is the idea that we should be aiming at a society with an equal equal distribution of goods. And the distinction that I make in the essay that I just wrote about it for the Patreon,
fine grain versus coarse grain.
Yeah, so in other, or you could just say like strict egalitarianism and loose egalitarianism.
Okay, right? Before you do that, I'm going to interrupt you, sir.
Sure, go for it.
Egalitarianism predates socialism.
Yeah, I mean, one of the main slogan of the French Revolution was, you know, liberté, égalité, fraternité, right? You know, égalité is the middle term there. The idea that some kind of equality is desirable is certainly something that is an idea that's been out there since before socialism has. I mean, equality for who, equality in respect of what, you know, obviously these things are all complicated, but just the distinction I was just going to make was that kind of, you know, I say like coarse-grained egalitarianism, that's like the idea, or loose egalitarianism, that's the idea that, like, you know, we should be aiming at least a roughly equal distribution of goods, that there's such a thing as way too unequal, that, you know, there's such a thing as unacceptably unequal. Whereas like fine-grained egalitarianism or strict egalitarianism would be the idea that that it's very important that we have an exactly equal distribution of goods. And when I think about that, I often think about the scene from the movie Casino, where Robert De Niro's character Ace Rothstein storms into the kitchen to demand that the chef put exactly as many blueberries in each mm-hmm. muffin. And I think oftentimes that's the kind of caricature that the right has of, you know, leftists or socialists, that, you know, that we're very concerned with like having some all-powerful bureaucracy make sure that everybody has the exact same outcomes as everybody else. And, you know, I don't want to say nobody says that, because every time I say nobody says that, you can always find one guy somewhere who says it.
Well, that's what we envision when we think of Maoist China.
Sure.
We think of everybody wearing the same outfits and thinking the same thoughts. Is that true?
Even with Maoist China, which is a very, you know, very authoritarian, you know, very conformist society, so there's certainly a germ of truth there. I don't, you know, it might be a little bit exaggerated, but in... But yeah.
And so the right will say socialism, fine-grained egalitarianism mows down your ego and just turns you into the masses. Yeah. It's no like, individualism.
Yeah. It's like the classic Kurt Vonnegut short story, Harrison Bergeron, where they do, you know, which is this sort of playful dystopia where they do things like put masks on excessively beautiful people so nobody will be that much better looking than anybody else, and, you know, and artificially mentally handicapped, you know, particularly smart people, so nobody will be smarter than anybody else. And of course, yeah, that's not what almost anybody in the Harrison Bergeron case, maybe literally anybody on the left advocates. So I think that in a sense, you say, okay, is reducing inequality, all else being equal, something's valuable? Yeah. I mean, I think that it's one thing to say that that we shouldn't have a society where, like, there's a video by the YouTuber ContraPoints where she shows this restaurant in New York where people are, like, rich people are literally eating gold leaf pizza.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, which doesn't even sound fun, but, you know, I guess it's just a way to, you know, really display how much money you have to throw around. And of course, not very far away, there are people who are literally sleeping on the street, and you say, okay, that's obviously an obscene amount of inequality. We don't want that. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we're, you know, obsessed with, like, having that, you know, that we want Maoist China, that we or that we want a probably, of course, in Maoist China, there are party bureaucrats who are actually, you know, living much better than ordinary people. But, you know, it doesn't mean that we want, you know, that sort of all powerful bureaucracy making sure there's exactly as many blueberries in every muffin. It's just that, you know, that we think that that's a symptom that something has gone terribly wrong. And just to finish up the thought, Karl Marx, in one of those books that your son probably read in the original German, The Critique of the Gotha Program, which is one of the last things he wrote.
What is the Gotha Program?
Yeah, so the historical context of this was in 1875, the two big socialist parties in Germany were merging together into a unified party, what became the Social Democratic Party of Germany. They had this, and they were going to have the unification conference in this German city, Gotha, and the proposed party platform for the new United Party was sent to Marx for his critical comments. And so that document that he wrote, giving his comment, you know, giving his notes on the Gotha program, is called Critique of the Gotha Program. And in it, he, you know, well, you know, he criticizes various things that they say about equality and things like that in the program. But the most interesting thing that he says is at the end of the first section, where he says that this whole question of the distribution of consumer goods is a secondary question anyway, because the real heart of the matter is who owns the means of production. That because under capitalism, the means of production, by which he means, you know, factories, farms, stores, all that stuff, are in the hands of non-workers, that's why we have such a horrible distribution of income on the other end.
Mm-hmm.
Solve the ownership issue and you've solved the distribution issue. So in other words, you might have, it might be that even in a socialist society where workers cooperatively owned the factories and the farms and all that stuff, that, you know, you might still have some, you know, some inequality in distribution because, you know, some people for whatever reason are able to or inclined to work harder, you know, than other people. And, you know, you want to incentivize that, but you wouldn't have these massive inequalities in distribution of the kind that you get in the contemporary United States, where some people are eating gold leaf pizza and some mm-hmm. people are sleeping on the street.
Well, I started this segment by saying we would talk to my audience. They're going back to work this week.
Yeah.
And they're all miserable, partly because they listen to my show.
Sure, sure.
But everybody's miserable. Everybody's at a job they can't stand. I don't know anybody who is cashing a paycheck, who drops to their knees and says, thank you, God, for this job and this bounty. They're just miserable. What is happening to us? It's been going on since we turned 16 and started working for a living. You're a pure Marxist. You're unapologetically Marxist. America is, I don't know what you would call this cesspool. I guess it's crony capitalism, whatever. I think there are different economic systems at play in every nook and cranny of our country. I think, you know, we see different types of economic systems at work, but mostly it's, I need to make as much money as I possibly can, even if it means losing my friends and family. That's mostly what's going on. But it's disguised. We're told different things. This is not your family. When I was growing up, my parents would take me to events that were sponsored by my father's job. And I was young and naive, and I thought these were my parents' friends. And then they would disappear, or my father would have new friends. And it was all under the guise of, we're a family. And then I'd get jobs as a comedy writer, and we were a team, and everybody would get their chance at bat. But the truth is, it wasn't baseball. You didn't get a chance to swing at a pitch. Baseball is the lie that's put on capitalism, isn't it? That everybody gets a chance. The problem is baseball. Baseball perpetuates the lie of capitalism, that we all get a chance at bat. And if we can swing for the fences and hit it out of the park, we'll be recognized. But that's not what happens in a job.
No, it's definitely not. I mean, it might happen to a certain extent for some people, but of course, one way that baseball is unlike a market economy is that in baseball, everybody starts at the same place. And that's a pretty crucial distinction. And at baseball, everybody, you know, has, assuming that you can advance, you know, if you're good enough, and that's just a matter of you being good enough versus the people who are on the other team being good enough. Everybody is passing through the same stages, which also isn't true, right? So,
the problem with baseball is,
yeah,
it's the American pastime. Everybody in baseball, unless you were African American or a woman or whatever, but I'm talking about now, the baseball myth that's draped over capitalism is everybody gets a shot. If the ball is hit to you and you catch it, everybody knows that you caught the ball. Somebody's keeping score. As a kid, my dad would take me to a game and he'd show me how to fill out the card. You can point to your home run average and the number of hits you got. And when you're standing at home plate and being pitched to, and you swing and you miss, you fail, you know you failed, and you can't complain. But that's not capitalism, is it? That's not what happens at a job.
No, it's not. I mean, at some jobs, to some extent, you might have a chance to distinguish yourself, but that's certainly not like, I mean, for one thing, most, you know, like as many legitimate complaints as you might have or I might have, you know, most jobs under capitalism are a lot less cushy than a philosophy professor or comedy writer. That, you know, most, you know, I don't know exactly how you're supposed to, you know, swing for the bleachers as a, you know, as a worker at a meatpacking plant, you know, but,
the manager in baseball, the manager isn't competing against you. He's encouraging you because if you don't, he's not on the playing field. His sole purpose is to make you a better player. But that doesn't happen in capitalism, does it?
Yeah, no. And, you know, it's not, yeah, no, I mean, I think it's very unlike baseball in just about every dimension, but it is a useful analogy because that is how we're taught to think about it, you know. And
so it must be our fault if we don't get the raise, or if we get fired, it must be our fault because we think of baseball.
Yeah, well, and in fact, yeah, actually the point you just made is the crucial one, which is that the most important distinction between playing a game of baseball and, you know, your successes or failures in that, and your successes or failures in your work life, is that as you say, you know, they have the manager, you know, like, you know, the coach, you know, is of your baseball team is trying to do everything possible to make sure you do as well as possible in the game because that's in his interest. But of course, in a workplace, in really important respects, you and the management are not on the same team.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that they have, and, you know, certainly you and the owners who management represents their interests are not on the same team, because if you if you think of success, right, the equivalent of, you know, of making that home run or whatever is you're getting a raise, you're getting, you know, this or that, right? Well, every dollar extra that you get is a dollar that your boss is a dollar that your boss doesn't get in profits, right? You have directly opposed interests. Every dollar the extra that they get in profits is a dollar that you don't get in wages. So it's taking. So, you know, if you're taught to think about your work life as if it were a game of baseball, you're thinking of a metaphor where everybody's on the same team and everybody's pulling for you. And so, you know, to the extent that you don't succeed, that's just because, you know, you weren't good enough, or the people on the other team, which would presumably in this metaphor be like rival companies or whatever, were too good. But of course that takes out the crucial dimension that in the game of capitalism, you and the boss are not on the same team. You're on opposing teams.
Mm-hmm. And in the game of capitalism, your boss doesn't want you to be good at your job. He doesn't want you to be better than he is. He doesn't want you to be so good that you can ask for more money. He just wants you to be okay at your job, because the boss only cares about his job.
Yeah, I mean, there's some conflicting imperatives for him, maybe, because he has to, on the one hand, you know, he wants to squeeze everything that he can out of you. On the other hand, doesn't want to have to, you know, he doesn't want to have to give you more money. Which is why, I mean, this, which is a dilemma, which is why what we're seeing a lot now in every sector of the economy, is the move towards the Uberization of everything, you know, that, because if everybody is coming, to get, you know, if all of your employees are at a central place and they're getting paid, whether or not they're producing or not, then, what you have to do as a boss is to really crack the whip and make sure that you're squeezing as much work out of them as possible. But now, and of course it's not new, it's going back to much earlier labor practices that we got rid of. But now they're, remembering that there's another way to do it, which is to have this kind of piecework system, you know, where, you don't have to, you know, if you pretend that somebody is something other than a full-time employee, then you can, you know, then you don't have to, like, try to crack the whip all the time and squeeze every penny out of them. They'll, like, hustle for you, and you still don't have to pay them that much. So, you know, like, Uber drivers who are legally independent contractors, even though they're employees in every way, or for that matter, adjunct professors who have, you know, like very often will every single year, year after year, will be given exactly one fewer class per academic year than what under the contract would require reclassifying those full time.
That goes on in universities right now. It's the same thing that goes on in fast food restaurants. They keep you under 37 hours a week so they don't have to pay you health benefits. And that's going on in universities.
Yeah, exactly. It's if you taught one, you know, you're right at the line, and if you taught one more class, they'd be contractually obligated to reclassify you as full time and give you health care. But one fewer than that, you don't. And in fact, oftentimes people who are in that situation end up working much more than people with full time jobs, because then since you're not making a full time salary and you have to buy health care through the exchange, then you try to pick up other classes elsewhere to supplement what you're doing there. Or you pick up classes maybe in the summer semester because maybe that's not, you know, considered part of the regular contractual year. And so the people, you know, so people who are under this legal fiction of being part-time end up working more than people who are officially full-time.
American universities squeeze money out of the students and the professors. We are told that you can't get a job unless you have a college degree. So the kids rack up debt to get that degree. And we have adjunct professors teaching at six different colleges, sleeping in their cars.
Yeah, absolutely.
There is a serious problem with the way we educate and teach and treat our educators in this country.
There is.
How do we get to this point that we allow this? Because if you walk on a college campus, all you see is construction and money and these massive endowments. And yet the kids are in debt, and there are fewer and fewer professors, and they're not teaching. The teaching is done by, in many cases, homeless people.
Yeah.
How does that happen?
Well, I think there are a few different factors. One of them is the decline in state funding for universities over the last few decades. Oftentimes there'll be some specific fundraising campaign to pay for that construction. And, you know, they don't go to the wealthy donors to say, hey, can we pay instructors a living wage? They go say, hey, can we build a new stadium? And then another thing is that as universities, including allegedly public ones, have gotten more and more corporatized, there's this phenomenon where people who often have no educational background themselves, but, you know, who come out of the world of management, MBAs, things like that, are hired as administrators, and since they all think they're indispensable, they keep hiring more of each other, and it becomes this, things become really bloated on the top, you know, with people with like really unclear job descriptions, you know, as the executive vice president in charge of, you know, synergizing creative solutions or whatever. And so that's definitely part of it. And of course, so I think part of the problem is that things are relatively, traditionally academics have bought into the idea that they're middle class professionals and that sort of conception of themselves, which means that that oftentimes, even if there is a faculty union, it's very weak, you know, because people don't really think of themselves.
Is it getting better? I mean, what I've been reading is, I think adjunct professors are making demands and going out on strike. Is it getting better?
I mean, it is, although let's not exaggerate. I mean, I think that what we're seeing right now is maybe the first rumblings, or not, yeah, obviously it's not the first, you know, but like we're seeing some unrest on an unusually large scale. Now, whether that kind of unrest is like, turns out to be like the, you know, the Arab Spring, where, you know, there's unrest for a little while and then things go back to, you know, being run by dictators, or whether it's something that's going to have more lasting consequences, isn't maybe totally clear yet, but I think it's one way or the other. It's a step in the right direction, you know, that like,
well, I think the kids have to be asked, you're going into debt. What are you paying for the rest of your life?
That's tricky too, because the honest truth is that this idea that a college degree by itself is going to guarantee you some kind of middle class existence when you get out is pretty dubious, and there's a structural problem here. I mean, having to do with capitalism and supply and demand, which is
what was drummed into my head. That universities and colleges were an oasis from capitalism. They were separate. It was a utopia where professors and students could pursue the truth with no Pentagon funding, no financial Wall Street influence. That's a lie.
It
right?
is. I mean, you know, maybe that's some people's experience to a certain extent, but you know.
The guy, any guy who's the president or chancellor of a university or of a college didn't get to the top because of his pursuit of the truth.
No, well, that's for sure. I mean, he most likely got to the top because he's really good at buttering up donors. But
so they wear robes and they hand out degrees. It's kind of like the Catholic Church, isn't it? A lot of ceremony, a lot of ritual, but underneath it all is real estate, money, and cover-ups.
Yeah, so I guess...
They even call it the College of the Cardinals.
Right. Yeah, no, there's definitely some of that, right? That sort of combination of, in both cases, of medieval pageantry and
so why do I tell my children...
problems.
I tell my kids, I tell everybody who's young,
yeah,
figure out a way to just stay in college for the rest of your life. If you can have a life, I've always wanted that life, where you're just living somewhere, teaching, racking up degrees, getting PhDs, living the life of the mind, doing charity at the same time. There's nothing better. I couldn't cut it. I couldn't pull that off. But there are certain people who are able to live that life.
Yeah.
I still believe that. But
I think that it's a tremendously valuable experience, and it's a human good to be able to live that life for a few years, and you know, and to kind of get that grounding in you know, reading and thinking, you know, for the rest of your life. But this, it is important that we think about how we pitch this, right? Because if you know, like, as you know, good Bernie bros, you know, we say that we want to abolish college tuition, that there's a bad way of arguing for that and a good way of arguing for that, because we don't want to say that this is some sort of magical cure to economic inequality, because it's not that, right? Mm-hmm. Even right now, plenty of people graduate from college without being able to translate it into any sort of better job that they could get without it. And you could say, oh, well, that's because they're majoring in, you know, impractical nonsense like, you know, modern dance or philosophy, you know. But the problem is with supply and demand that if everybody was getting those, you know, the most marketable STEM degrees, then the economic value of getting those degrees would plummet. Because the more people who have them, the less it's going to be able to command in the labor market. And we should be honest about this, because even more generally, like, for whatever good just having a degree in anything does you in the labor market, the more people who have one, the less good it's going to do you. So I don't think we can sell it, you know, honestly, as we should have a guaranteed right to higher education, you know, without tuition, because it's going to be a passport to upward mobility. I think we should say no. It's not, you know, but that's okay, right? You know, mm-hmm. we're not primarily interested in helping, you know, the few, the best and the brightest, you know, climb their way up the ladder better, right? I mean, that's the that's what neoliberal politicians have been interested in. But like, I think we can have a better vision where what we want is to raise the floor for everybody, you know, have a variety of economic programs that are going to make life better for people at the bottom of society. And then everybody should get to go to college, not because getting to go to college is going to mean that you're going to be paid more later in life. In some cases, it might mean that, but primarily because you just have a better and richer life if you get to go to college. And that's something that people shouldn't be denied because they can't afford it or their parents can't afford it.
Is the problem capitalism or is the problem America? Is the problem the United Kingdom? Germany will educate my son for free and he can stay in the universities for the rest of his life if he moves to Germany. Is the problem America? Is the problem the United Kingdom?
Even in America and the United Kingdom, the history is a little bit complicated on this stuff. There used to be, what's now the City University of New York used to be City College, used to be tuition free if you got in. Mm-hmm. There used to be some state university systems in the United States that were tuition free.
So the problem is America then, not necessarily capitalism.
Well, I think that the point, here's how I would think of it. I think that the sort of default mode of capitalism is to try to ruthlessly squeeze out as much as possible from everybody all the time. But then it's possible that you, through fighting really hard, you can get concessions, that you can, even within capitalism, that you can get the bosses to agree to a better deal. It's not a matter of the 1% in Germany being innately more compassionate than the 1% in the United States, or just having better cultural values or anything. And I mean, I could actually think of some examples where Germans have done bad things. If you really stretch your mind, it's an issue of successful political organizing to achieve these things, which is uneven between countries and sometimes even between parts of countries. I don't think there's anything in the water in Germany that they can have that there, but not here. I think that, if we elect Bernie Sanders and we clean this sort of neoliberal corporate shill Democrats out of Congress and, have a wave of better people in Congress and have the kind of grassroots organizing that it would take to sort of push all this stuff through, be a very hard fight. But I don't see any reason why we couldn't have those sorts of social democratic reforms in this country, too.
Yeah. Well, let me make an observation and then you get the last word and hopefully you'll come back next week. I think of actresses meeting with Harvey Weinstein. And they go up to his room, they want a job, and he rapes them, and they get the job.
Yeah.
They go up to his room because they want a job, and he tries to rape them. They run out of the room, and they don't get the job.
But
when you dealt with Harvey Weinstein, he was a capitalist in the true sense of the word, wasn't he? Because that is capitalism, isn't it? Capitalism is to rape, to take away everything you possibly can from somebody before you hand them the paycheck. That's what it is. To separate slavery from capitalism is disingenuous. Built into capitalism is slavery, and slavery is rape. It steals everything from you. Unless there are laws, that's what capitalism is. Slavery.
This gets back to what we were talking about earlier about inequality and about the sources of inequality, which is that, even in this giant spectrum going all the way from uh, I you know, they're not really being straight with me about why I didn't get that job or why I'm being let go from this job or what have you, on one end of the spectrum, to the kind of, you know, of harassment and humiliation, and even rape, you know, that Harvey Weinstein was carrying out, you know, what all these things have in common are that they're things that they can get away with, because of this structural imbalance of power, because of the fact, that somebody like Harvey Weinstein, and by the way, a while back, I was rewatching some old episodes of the TV show, Entourage, from, you know, I think this was from, like, I don't know, 2005 or something. And there's a character in there who's a very thinly disguised Harvey Weinstein, who's like called like Harvey Weinberg or something. And you know, they didn't show him raping anybody, but they certainly portrayed him as being a raging asshole and a crazy person and somebody everybody understood these things about. And the fact that they could do that portrayal while he, you know, that like, it could be that much of an open secret, you know, tells you something, because this is something, you know, I mean, this is, you know, you're talking about the Catholic Church earlier, you know, like the same way that there are things that you can get away with, you know, that you can get away with if people think that you, you know, hold the keys to salvation, that, you know, that you're the link between them and God, that, you know, that you can get away with all these abuses. You know, if people are put in this kind of such a position of power that there's really no accountability, and they have, and they're certainly not accountable to you, right? Mm-hmm. You know, they have, you know, there might be other investors or shareholders they're accountable, but they're damn sure not accountable to you. Then yeah, you can, they could get away with all of these things, and it's the same reason, because they decide, you know, ultimately. You know, you can, you know, if you have certain kinds of skills, you can negotiate a little bit. If you're part of a union, you can negotiate a little bit more. But ultimately, they decide what goes into wages and what goes into profits, you know, because if you had an equal say in that, you would never agree to that, right? Right. You would never say, oh, yeah, I agree. All of this should, you know, this giant chunk, this should all just go off into you because you have a piece of paper saying that you own this. And similarly, if people had, you know, were able to have a, you know, meaningfully equivalent power and bargain from that place, you know, and, you know, people, you know, so people weren't worried that Harvey Weinstein was going to, you know, ruin their career, do this and that, then that he, you know, he would have been in jail decades ago.
Yeah. There's a great story this past weekend about Scott Pelley, who was the anchorman on CBS News. I liked Scott Pelley, and suddenly he disappeared. He was no longer the anchor man, and he gave an interview to CNN over the weekend, and he said that he saw a culture of rape at CBS, of abuse and rape. He felt it was his responsibility as the anchor man of the CBS Evening News to complain, and he kept complaining, and nobody would do anything about it, and he took his complaint all the way up to the president of CBS, Les Moonves, who was a rapist, is a rapist, not in prison yet, but he's a rapist. Les Moonves said, we'll look into this. And they looked into Scott Pelley's contract and fired him. He was essentially sort of a whistleblower and got punished. At least this is his version of events. He spoke up and he got fired from CBS Evening News, replaced by a zero. I remember watching this guy, Jeff Gore, whatever his name is. I'm going, really? You replaced Scott Pelley for this guy? And now I go, oh, yeah, this guy keeps his mouth shut. You can rape around this guy. You can't rape around Scott Pelley. Had I been Scott Pelley's psychiatrist, I would say to him, keep your mouth shut. Why are you complaining about a culture of rape? That's insanity. You can't change this culture. Just take your check and cash it. Keep your mouth shut or leave. This is the culture. You can't change it. I just think of people going to work today, the insanity of thinking today is going to be different. You had your 3-day weekend. And today, it's going to be different. You're going to show up to work, and they're going to recognize your genius or recognize that your plan is the right way to proceed. The fact that it probably is the right way to proceed is why they won't go down that path. Most jobs in America are complete and utter bullshit. They're unnecessary, and they're used to disguise people's incompetence and make things more expensive for the client. If you have 50 people working on a job, you can charge the client more for it. Most jobs are bullshit and unnecessary, aren't they?
Yeah.
So the solution is what? A guaranteed basic income, turn it all over to the robots, and we should just be reading and having sex.
Yeah, no, sounds good to me. I just add that better make sure the machines are collectively owned, or this isn't going to go well.
How does this work? Basically, if you look at our economy in a pure, pure grain egality? What is it called?
Oh, yeah.
Fine grained.
Yeah, sure.
We're each entitled to $300,000 a year.
Something like that, yeah.
if you were to take our multi-trillion dollar economy and spread it across the 350 million Americans, we're each entitled to $300,000 a year, something like that, of a guaranteed basic income. And if you start from that position and start looking at our federal budget and what it's spent on, it'd make you really angry.
Yeah.
Anyway, Ben Burgis is the author of Give Them an Argument, Logic for the Left. It's published by Zero Books. Everybody should go to the YouTube channel where Zero Books is producing some really amazing videos that are funny and educational and will get you to start thinking. You don't need pot. You don't need acid. You just need Ben Burgis. It will really alter the way you look at what's in front of you. Once you start reading Ben Burgis, you will see things differently in a new light. And for me, it makes me a better worker bee. Once I accept the exploitation, I don't take it personally. And once you no longer take it personally, you can hit back and take some things from management. He has a new Patreon account. Go to patreon.com/Ben Burgis and support this man. Get two essays delivered to your inbox each week, plus some videos, and watch them tonight and every Tuesday night on The Michael Brooks Show on YouTube. Thank you, sir. Can you stay on the line?
Absolutely.